It's a great racing shoe. You know it's going to perform. It's a Ferrari for sure. It's not something you want to train in. It's not like the Nissan you want to take to the grocery store. That's what I think of my Ultras as. They're sedan I take to the supermarket or running around town. These are the Ferraris that show up to the track. Track being trails. I don't do the track. Tracks are terrible. 'Cause I want to be like the wind.
All right, hey Trails Collective, Ian here with teammate Jay Lemos weighing in to start the review. So we are going to take you through a bit of the short course version on the review of the Salomon S-Lab Cross. You can find a longer version out there as well for those who might want a little bit deeper dive. So the Salomon S-Lab Cross, one that debuted in 2020, is a model that really pushes, I think, the boundaries of materials, design, functionality, and just kind of coolness. I think at some point yesterday I had a flashback looking at the shoe to Montrail Susitna, which at the time seemed like a pretty cool advanced shoe in terms of materials. Now it seemed pretty archaic, but again, it was just that association, that something that was kind of pushing the boundaries. So Salomon S-Lab Cross, who's it designed for? It's really designed to be a really lightweight, minimal, uber flexible, beast of a shoe to go through really loose or soft ground terrain or mud. Taking you through some of the specs right off the bat, price $180, definitely in the top tier, and I think it's a combination of the materials they're using, lower production, and really, well, I think you'll feel it. As Jay mentioned in the beginning, it feels more like a Ferrari on your foot, and I think that's really how it's designed. Weight, 8.1 ounces, and I think are 230 grams. And I think we both feel it feels even lighter than that on your foot because it really just kind of melds with your foot and ankle. So it feels like one package. Stack height. Reported stack height is 13 millimeters in the heel, 9 in the forefoot. I think that's really inclusive of just the midsole. I do have a goniometer here at the shop where I can do my own measurements just because I feel like we're not getting the same iterator kind of reliability or metric out of companies. So when I measure it, I get 16 in the heel, 12 in the forefoot, and then tack on 1 millimeter for a fused top sole, which is on the inside. This model does not have a removable insole. You've got about probably 1 millimeter for the lasting and 1 millimeter for the outsole rubber. It's got 6 millimeter lugs on the bottom, really aggressive. The lugs that are there, in theory or conceptually, they're modeled after a gecko's foot, designed to really mold and adapt to terrain and have really exceptional stickiness, particularly over soft and wet ground. The upper, I think I mentioned it has a drop of 4 millimeters. So the upper is pretty slick. The most visible thing is the gaiter. It has a stretchy, kind of almost thin sock neoprene type feel to it. It extends from up over the ankle and then all the way through to the forefoot around the toes. It has a quick lace design system with its lace garage right in the middle of where the tongue would be. And it has a bit of padding right along this section of the tongue to prevent compression or a bit of discomfort in what may have been there over the quick laces over the instep. I think functions really well. Grabs the up around the ankle, compresses well. There's not a whole lot of excess material in there. Woven down into the sock-like upper, you've got padding in here, which suffices as a traditional heel collar. Otherwise, not really any heel cup down there, really flexible. And then what encapsulates that sock-like upper is the shroud. And this shroud here, which extends from the rear of the shoe through to the vamp, has a couple functions. One is keeping you fairly stable over the upper of the shoe, over varied terrain. It also has a bit of protection. And what's making it pretty exceptional is that they're weaving in aramid fiber. So I kind of call it the shroud of aramid. And Aramid has one of its trade names is Kevlar, something that's also used in another model up here, the VJ Max, which has a really bomb-proof upper. It's so far in our mileage, Jay has a little bit over 200 miles in it. It's proving really durable. It has a rubberized lamination of a toe cap, which extends all the way around the medial and lateral sides of the shoe. And that really, I think, holds things together as well. It also acts in that lamination coming up, not only for abrasion resistance, but also a little bit more water resistance to keep water out of the shoe. But the other really cool part about the upper, and this is something I was really excited about when I saw the pre-production model a year or so out, was the upper is also hydrophobic, so it just doesn't take on water. So I put it through several creek crossings, intentionally really jumping into some. And while I could feel my sock and maybe the upper here in the gaiter felt a little bit wet, the material in the shroud and lower just didn't at all. And so the shoe does drain, but you're not necessarily feeling the drainage. What you're feeling is just the hydrophobic nature of the upper, where it just feels dry almost immediately, which is really cool. So midsole that they're using is Energy Cell Plus. It's one that they use in some other models, including the Speed Cross. But it feels, just in terms of on a very uber flexible light package, feels totally different than it feels in the Speed Cross. Here it feels light, bouncy, fairly responsive. If you had the Speed Cross at one end of the spectrum, Wild Cross would probably be in the middle, and then the S-Lab Cross on the other side. It really does feel pretty exceptionally different. They use ContraGrip TA for an outsole rubber. It's one that they designed for loose and soft ground, and they also use it in their Amphib model. And so it's got pretty great stickiness or tackiness to it, and the durability has been pretty solid as well. So, running in the shoe. One thing that you're going to have to be, the person that this is going to be right for, you've got to want to feel and embrace a shoe that just has this much flexibility to it. Shorter distances, racing feels outstanding. As you get into upper miles, maybe, and I guess that's a relative concept for somebody, you for sure feel that work. Your foot just has to do it. It'll go over technical terrain, including rocks, and you'll feel those. But what you're also doing is it's responding, and it's very malleable in those rock sections, but you're definitely feeling the shots and the hits. And so for somebody who's maybe doing predominantly very kind of rocky terrain, it's not that the protection isn't decent. I think it's got enough cushioning here where you can go over the rocks and feel okay. It's just your foot's got to do a lot of the work to absorb that. So it's been pretty exceptional. Jay's got 200 miles in it. I only have about 50, 60 in mine, and it's holding up quite well. So pretty awesome. So particularly for Jay, as he mentioned in one of his clips, really the design here with the gaiter melded down into the vamp, down into wrapping into a heel, it really does take on basically becomes an extension of your foot. Being in an S-Lab series, the silhouette, in terms of the fit right out of the box, is very narrow in the heel, very narrow in the midfoot, but particularly with some of their 2020 models, they're opening it up more in the forefoot. I think that's to go after a larger audience, and particularly the US market, but it fits with more volume than traditional S-Lab models would. And as soft as the materials are, and as soft both in the midsole as well as the upper, for even myself who has a little bit lower or dropped midfoot, I still feel totally comfortable in this. Whereas, or comparatively, something in the Speed Cross would totally bite in and abrade my midfoot. So I think it accommodates more foot types than maybe some of the Cross series would in the past. Comparisons. Hoka Evo Jaws comes in at 130. It has a fairly similar underfoot feel, really aggressive lug pattern. Another shoe that I loved. Downside to it was, over technical terrain, it has issues where the upper will just separate and delaminate, from the toe cap. But one to compare it to. Another one that's not in the store would be the X-Talon G235 from Innovate. Also $185 price point shoe, so it's up there. It's going to have a firmer ride and a little bit narrower toe. So somebody maybe who is historically an S-Lab fan, that X-Talon G235 may be something to check out. Also exceptionally sticky rubber and a durable outsole. So far, We've been really happy with this shoe. It does really what it's designed to do, and the durability has been excellent. So if you want a deeper dive than that, check out the longer review, and we will have that linked. So thanks for tuning in, and we will check you later. See ya. And it's a trade name within Salomon is called the Matrix Fiber. And just as really as badass as this shoe looks, and knowing that they're intentionally using the term matrix, I just thought how much cooler it would be if Neo in the film Matrix actually were sporting these bad boys, how much just more effective he may have been in a scene like this.